Okay, so good morning or good noon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for coming to this talk. We are today hearing something about a very new project and working group, which is the Oscar project and the Open SCA working group. We're going to understand what the difference is, what supports what, why there is Oscar, what it addresses, and in what state it is. So first of all, just clarification about these terms. I think you're all familiar with the Eclipse projects and the concept of an Eclipse working group. So Oscar is the name of the Eclipse project, and OpenSCA is the, if you want, the umbrella function that supports Oscar, maybe more in the future, but at the very first beginning, it will be all around Oscar. Before we, maybe I should explain just quickly what Oscar stands for. It stands for Open Software Composition Analysis Reinvented. So there is tools out there that address software composition analysis. There's both commercial tools out there, and there's also some open source tools, which we will see later. And the goal of Oscar is really to pack all these initiatives together and identify alternatives and hopefully better solutions. Why Oscar? So the motivation to create Oscar is that there is existing commercial SCA solutions. There is solutions that go into code and analyze code and come to conclusions about that code. Specifically, there are solutions around that scan for open source with the goal of identifying licenses, with the goal of identifying potential problems or non-problems, conflicts, obligations, etc. So there is an existing market. This market was basically started a little bit more than 10 years ago when the first offerings of those solutions came out. One of the problems of this situation is that this market is being consolidated currently. So there's a lot of tools out there that have been gone into a different context, that have been bought out. And there is only some new arrivals to this market, and that causes some problem with the existing users. So especially large users of these tools, they just don't really know where this all goes to. So there's an unclear future. Oops. Don't know why that did that. There's an unclear future, and there's questions to be asked both to the suppliers but also to maybe other suppliers. So the reality is that people are using more than one tool currently, and they are questioning whether the tools that they have in use are still the best choice. Lacking flexibility. Due to the market consolidation, there is less flexibility at the supplier side to say, okay, your requirements are understandable, let's move on and sit on a table and think about changes of the products. So that's all a bit of the reason why there needs to be more flexibility, and open source very often is the answer to that. Most or all of these tools are not really developer-focused. So going into analysis is very much a forensic exercise in enterprises, in large development shops. So this means very often that this goes to separate units within the organization, and that causes time delay between days and weeks until a result is going back to development. So that is something which is a problem and needs to be addressed, which we found out. Benefits of the open source and open data. Are you seeing? What's happening here? So I don't know what's happening. I'm talking to a slide, and I'm seeing something different here. Anyway, so the benefits of being open source are are obvious. I mean, all the usual suspects like sharing results, having common data pools, being in the middle of a contribution pool, and also with this slightly fuzzy sentence, the sky's the limit. There is stuff that will be in Oscar, definitely right from the beginning, but there's so much that existing tools don't deliver. So the sky's the limit stands for the wish list can be endless, and it still should be managed. Some current state how people are using partially open source and partially commercial softwares. This is open material here. This is just an excerpt from one of the Bitkom events that happened lately. So we see how HERE is doing stuff or planning to do stuff. We see you probably, if you have been in the talk right before this, you will recognize the Bosch solution. There is a picture of how SAP is doing stuff with commercial software, and there's also a picture stolen from a Siemens talk, which talks about how Fossology is being used in conjunction with other tools. So that's the existing situation, is that there is already a mix between commercial tools and open source tools. So what is Oscar today? Well, the people may think that it's really, you know, it's really at the start. So it's a blank piece of paper or a whiteboard, which is partially true, because as I said, we are in the process of establishing the project, doing first commitments, establishing the working group, etc. But let's before we talk about what is actually already there, let's quickly talk about some of the goals that have been defined in conjunction with Oscar. And talking about these goals, I mean, where do these goals come from? Let's take one step back and discover, you know, how these goals came together. So there's a group around a software company, which is my software company, CodeScoop. And this group of people have all more or less a background in the SCA field. So they all have a history with OpenLogic, with Palomita, with Black Duck, name it. And that means they have worked with big users of this kind of software for 8 or 10 years. So they have understood what are the gaps, what's missing with existing software, what are the wish lists for future establishments, etc. And they have somehow sensed a common sense of things that need to be done, that need to be open sourced, because of the reasons that we just went through. So that's how this list came together. And going through the list surfaces the following. So the first point is very much about, you don't really see that this is highlighted here, but it's about continuous scanning. So continuous scanning is something that is currently not happening. We saw in this slide, we saw that there are ways to establish continuous scanning with some restrictions. You talk about a specific projects in a specific language, etc. There's ways to do continuous scanning, but the idea really to do continuous software composition analysis for all kind of projects, that's not existing. So that's one point that's missing and is definitely worth having, getting the analysis as close to the I don't know what's happening here. As close to the development time as possible. So that's the first point. The second point is there is stuff around that can be used today. There are functionalities, micro-functionalities, and the people that we have talked to have expressed it would be great to have really a distribution. So to have one place to go to get workable pieces of software that don't have to be put together and combined, etc. So again, here the important part is it should be able to live anywhere. typically these solutions live on servers, some of them live on clouds, but very few of them live on workstations. So again, to be very fast, to be very close to the developer, it's probably necessary to have this on the workstation. The third aspect is that in true open source passage, this is also a specification of an architecture. So in order to have people the ability to chime in and to contribute to it, there should be a robust architecture being defined in OSCAR. The fourth point is very much about the, this should be OpenSCA, about the backup of industry supporters, both in terms of contribution, money, work, ideas, specifications, requirements, etc. Because typically what works in big development shops then also works in smaller development shops and also works in very small shops. So that's the fourth point. And last not least, everything should be done and organized in a publicly visible way, and that's the combination of a project and a working group. So actually, yeah, we're looking at some stuff that exists already. There's a lot of work in progress, but there's also, as I mentioned before, there's stuff that exists already. So there are. This is meant to also demonstrate these are typically, even if they are small entities supporting these single open source projects addressing single SCA topics, there's typically big companies behind it. There's companies like Google, like HERE, like Siemens behind it. And with that, I would like to call up Oliver Fendt, who is coming to us from Siemens to get you some input about Fossology and maybe some others that are relevant here. And I will probably refresh the screen.
Okay, Fossology. No, I decided to go another way. Let me spend some words on Software 360, which is this one. We at Siemens, we had the challenge that we needed a software catalog, which is able to manage our projects, our product projects, and to manage our components, our open source components, or inner source components, or even commercial components. And so we looked at the market, and you can imagine a big company has very special wishes. We did not find a solution which was there and which fits our purpose. So we decided to build a software catalog. Then we came to the conclusion that building software catalogs is not really the core competence of Siemens. So we decided then to make it an open source effort because we also thought that it might be useful for others. And the very driving reason for doing this as an open source project was that we do not want to be vendor dependent. This software catalog is a, let's say, a critical part of the infrastructure we have. Here our products are managed, our components are managed, and if we have a vendor lock-in, then we have to play according to the rules the vendor dictates. And imagine, for example, the vendor goes out of business. What happens? Or imagine the vendor perhaps changes the license conditions, like Oracle now changes the license conditions for Java. So vendor independence was a crucial point. And then, of course, we thought that it might be useful for others. Then all of a sudden, Bosch showed up and said, oh, this is interesting for us. And they started or said, oh, we want to contribute, but how should I say this? So sorry. We are not very comfortable to donate code to Siemens. And so we decided to make it an Eclipse project, and now it's an Eclipse project, and it's hosted by the Eclipse Foundation, and it's evolving. Another very important thing is that, as it was pointed out before, those nice compliance tools, which Software 360 is a part of those, were not built for developers. But if you want to make DevOps real working, you need to integrate the compliance stuff and the compliance work totally into the software development tool chain. And what is needed there is, of course, you have to have tools designed for the developers and not for the lawyers and not for the open source compliance officers, because you need a buy-in from the developers. And how can you achieve this? Very easy, I think, because those tools like Software 360 or Fossology or Quartermaster are open source, so they can look into the tools and they can adapt those tools to their workflows. I never saw up to now a commercial vendor which provided interfaces which fitted all purposes. This can be achieved via open source software. And we have seen in our development stuff that there are developers who are contributing functionality to those tools. And I think that's the best way to make DevOps at compliance really work in order to get our development cycles shorter and shorter.
Yeah, totally agreed. Yeah. Well, thank you very much. I can't agree more. So integration into DevOps and the processes that are necessary there, turning to the developer so things can be done very quickly and at the beginning of the development cycle. That's really what's needed. So we will not go into details here. So these are just a selection of projects that we have started to talk to, and they have expressed a vital interest in being part of OSCAR. Having talked to many people also meant that we had like a Christmas list. What else could be close to OSCAR, and what would be functionalities that are just beyond the normal scanning? We have just talked about scanning now, and there's a lot. There's open source obligations that I've talked about earlier. There's all kind of security problems that can be solved. There is simple technical things like there need to be plugins into IDE, so this can be done directly in the developer's environment. There need to be command language interface tools, etc. And a first try to put this into a sequential order is basically this. This is part also of the OSCAR project proposal. Pretty obviously, first things have to go first. So some things are depending on each other, so you can't do open source obligations if you haven't scanned or identified anything. So you can start with that. But that's still, the first part here, which is supposed to start in this quarter and the next quarter, is pretty obvious. But what is happening after that will be largely also decided by the working group. A logical, consequential architecture, if you pull in aspects like there needs to be control of source code, there needs to be metadata, there needs to be security data, is this, again, this is a draft, this is a potential or a proposed architecture, but some of the elements will not go away. So some of the orange data buckets that come from outside that need to be there, some of the internal sources where you access your own repositories and your own inner source information, and some of the automation objects here will be part of the architecture. Probably it will be bigger, maybe more complex, but that's the level of thoughts we have given this so far. So, with this, this should be probably the point where we have a drum roll or a nice music or I don't know, gold flitter falling from the ceiling. This is basically, I mean, this week is the week where we start this thing. Tomorrow, there's going to be an initial meeting with some of the industry backing people, and we are discussing with them that whether this is really what everybody agrees to do, whether the reasons are good enough to really launch this. I said the project submission is done, it can be reviewed and seen everywhere on the Eclipse platform. The charter proposal, so every working group needs a charter, that's currently under review by the Eclipse Foundation. We are pretty far, we still want to make it less complex. We believe that by November, December this year, the OpenSCA working group will be finalized and being established. First commitments, there are some commitment candidates right now, but they are kind of being held back until everything is decided. Will probably be done in Q1 next year. And depending on the complexity that Oscar will have, probably the first releases, there may be minor releases after 6 months. We are currently overlooking a term of 18 months until we think there's really beef at the stick, and what happens after that can't be seen at this point. Last word about before I finish. Last word is why Eclipse? Why are we doing that on Eclipse? Arguably, you know, there are other possible homes for us for this. We have looked at some, including building our own foundation, which was a stupid idea. But you know, sometimes you need to step into something just to feel that you're still living. We've looked at the big ones and we've looked at the medium ones. Eclipse is not one of the bigger ones, and that's one advantage. So we found that that there's a good match of both the goals in terms of, you know, what Oscar wants to achieve and what Eclipse stands for, developer-oriented, bridging the gap between enterprise software and individual software. All these things were a good match to what Oscar wants. And we have, I mean, the group that is currently driving this is feeling well inside the Eclipse Foundation. Let's face it. I mean, the warmth that we have felt to be greeted here at this conference, and you know, it's considerably easy to speak to the likes of Mike or Mark or Gail or Ralph. I mean, they are all available. And they all like the idea. They all are backing us up. So that helps if you're not just one of thousands or hundreds. We feel that the Eclipse has a certain Europe-minded background, which we feel is an advantage, because yes, there will also be, I mean, amongst, I didn't enumerate the industry backers, but I may mention that there will possibly also the likes of Disney or Cisco, so you know, over the pond, but many of the supporters that we are talking to now are here in Europe, and that helps. Eclipse is very much Europe-minded, so we like that. Developer focus we spoke about, and the existing, this is something that Eclipse takes out of the box. The project and working group schema is just there, and it just worked, and there's processes tied to it, there's marketing tied to it, there's internal stuff tied to it, the processes are mature. We like that. Why find something else? And that's, now finally, this slide is makes sense because it's resembling the first slide. Questions? Criticism, jokes, applause. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah. Machine learning should be part of it. Give me. Yeah. Yeah. Totally, totally. You're speaking almost out of my heart. I think some of the brute force methods that the classical SCA tools are using is just not out of this time anymore. So being smarter, not being repetitive, especially when it comes to identification if you have 12 findings and you don't know which one is the correct one. I totally agree. That could be something along the line, yeah. It doesn't?
It doesn't understand generated code.
That's right.
Every code, just a piece, is a snippet.
Yeah.
It's not aware that this code has been generated.
Yeah. Which is also, so the comment was that one particular supplier doesn't know how to treat generated code. Yes. The same is true for binary code. I mean, it's the same.
And images.
And images. Yeah.
Images, yeah. Names,
yeah. Yeah, that's... Image recognition, binary one-to-one recognition is probably an easy task, but if you want to do similarities, things have been scaled, that have been attached a logo to it, etc., that's, nobody does that. So if that's, I mean, still, it must be important. If like Disney is one of the big supporters, they have a saying in graphical information to be recognized and, you know, copyright, but license checked. And if it's only industrial supporters, then it's probably not so important for them. But you're right.
Do you have a rough idea about when I can download the Oscar scanner and run it on my software?
I wish I had. So let me turn that question around. So does that mean that you dig it, that you understand that this is valuable for a developer or for an organization? Yeah. Yeah. Do you want to answer?
It depends whether you talking about scanner in regard of a snippet scanner or in regard of a package analysis tool like.
In regard of, I have Eclipse tooling or a complete Eclipse IDE and want to run it, whether I violate some licenses.
Okay.
Some
okay. Then you are probably more speaking about a snippet scanner. And it's up to the Oscar project to decide when this is going to be implemented.
Exactly. So there's two aspects to it. Number one, you as a normal developer have no access to what Bosch is using somewhere else, probably. You can't just say, hey, can I use Protex or whatever they are using? That's probably a given fact. So even if you wanted to do that, you wouldn't, just by the architecture of the tools and the licensing model of the tools, you wouldn't be able to do that. So that's one of the ideas that we heard many times, that this should be moved to the place where code is really being created. And the second that you were addressing is you don't care whether this is compiled code or whether it's, you know, Java code or whether whether there needs to be something identified which maybe is slightly modified, which then causes a problem. You just want a health check or like a, how do you always say, Virginia? A spell checker, exactly. You want, while you're doing that, not even, I suppose you don't even want to run something, you want something that you have at hand, like a pane in the Eclipse environment, saying, oh, there's something reddish there, maybe I should look for it. That's exactly what we want to address with Oscar.
That would be maybe the perfect solution. I would be fine as first step if I could just run an Oscar license scanner on Jenkins that tells me, you imported something with a Google license, are you really sure that you want to
use that? Yeah. So not really real time, but at least at build time. Yeah. Your question. I mean, we didn't really answer your question. When can you use the first instance of it? And we gave you the legal answer. It depends. I would suspect that we get first usable versions pretty quick, but not full function. Not snippet scanning is a little bit of a more complex problem to solve. So if you're okay just to understand if something comes into your stack and has implications, then this will likely be very, very quick, 3-6 months maybe.
Yeah, because I think this use case can be really implemented very fast because there are already tools out And I think then it's up to Oscar to define the interfaces to those tools in order to connect them in a way that they will be part of the Jenkins pipeline. No? So that could be easily in quotes be done because there are already the building blocks there which are required to do that. Pardon, I didn't understand that.
Okay, so embed tools, what you enumerate probably have the command line interface and you can just call it from Jenkins. The problem is how to use that reporting result, right? So how to apply it. And it would be great to do it from IDE, like creating the builder, and then have the problem used, we feel it back, we feel it.
Yeah. You are right. You having the path to get the result is fine, but you also need a way back, so a path back in order to fix what you have messed up, probably. Yeah.
Just reporting we already have, we don't need partner reports, everything is wrong.
Yeah, that's more a process question than a tool question, but you're right, that needs to be addressed. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. On versions of available libraries, it's often mentioned that there is a security bug fix in a version 1.17 and only 1.15 is officially out.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where they get this data from. Is it planned to, or how? What's the idea? How will you fill your repository, your data storage with this information? Is it the way that you try to retrieve the information from the web, or you plan also for example, that the Apache community says, okay, I have here some special interface on a server or on a GitHub, and this is the way you have, where I register at Oscar, and there you can retrieve the latest.
Yeah, well, again, this is not carved into stone, but I think the openness of Oscar gives the chance that there is other sources for this kind of information than only the vulnerability database in the US. So definitely will there be information sources, security information sources that are in the development shop already, because there's already a lot existing. Companies like Siemens, they have subscribed to, I don't know, three or four or many, maybe not, but I mean, okay, more. Yeah, I'm glad because so they are doing their own due diligence already. So that is the first probably the first source to go and look. And then the ultimate, if we are talking open source, the ultimate way of doing this is really contributing. When you find something, you know, getting that feedback loop that which is not existing today. If you ask, I'm not trying to bash on Black Duck, but if you ask one of those leaders, what do you do if we find something? He will say, yeah, well, we'll eventually see it in vulnerability databases. Not good enough. So the beauty of something being detected in real time and then shared with everybody, so it can be reused with concrete context, where exactly is that, not just in JBoss, but you know exactly there using that functionality. That's not existing today, so that's something that could be on that list, and actually it is. Yeah.
For me as a developer, it would be nice to have the possibility to mark the code, to make an annotation to the code from this snippet I have taken from that website.
Okay. With the purpose of that, as a later scan would immediately take that into account. Yeah, keep those ideas coming. I mean, yes, of course. Yeah, it doesn't help with the fact that then the code is modified, but it makes it easier to reduce the number of false positives. And of course, yeah, These are examples of why an open platform makes sense, because you say, and how complicated can that be? It's very complicated to get that from a commercial vendor. Oh, why should we do that? And who pays that? And blah, blah, blah. That's not complicated stuff. Once the data model is there and the architecture is there and the interfaces are there, it's easy to make a contribution that does exactly that, if it's accepted and wanted by everybody, of course. All right, 12:29 says my clock here. Time for lunch. Thank you very much.